From 1927 to 1948, the Carter family recorded over 300 songs that now form the bedrock of country music.
There's a dark and a troubled side of life, but there's a bright and a sunny side too. Though you meet with the darkness and strife, the sunny side you also may view. Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day and we'll brighten on the way if we'll keep on the sunny side of life.
Many of the Carters' songs were up-tempo, but the lyrics reflected the harsh reality of early American life.
We don't feel like we need God like they did back then. They believed it. So they sang songs about, yes, there is a dark side of life, but you got to keep on the sunny side.
Let us greet with a song of hope each day, though the moment be cloudy or fair. And let us trust in our Savior always. He'll keep us, everyone, in His care. Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day and we'll brighten all the way if we'll keep on the sunny side of life. If we'll keep on the sunny side of life.
A.P. Carter was born in Poor Valley, Virginia in 1891. He grew up with his seven brothers and sisters in a small house under the shadow of Clinch Mountain.
He didn't have much education. He had this tremor in his hands, and he was born like that, where his hands shook all the time. Children made fun of him. They made fun of him because his hands trembled, and his mother took him out of school.
For the young A.P. Carter, making a living meant walking for miles across Clinch Mountain trying to sell fruit trees.
He stopped at this house, and this girl was sitting on the porch playing an order harp and a singing, and that was my mother, Sarah.
She was just a teenager at the time, very young, and I think that was the first of many more trips across the mountain, probably, for my granddad, because I think he really did probably fall in love with her that day.
A.P. married Sarah in 1915. Later, his brother married her cousin, May Bell. She too was musical, and the three of them started performing together. Sarah sang and played the auto harp, and May Bell brought her unique guitar style to the group.
When I started playing the guitar, I didn't have nobody to play with me, so that's how I developed the style of picking in the rhythm too, you know. Mm-hmm. And they call it the Carter Scratch now, some of them do.
She did the lead and the rhythm at the same time. Mm-hmm. She didn't have to have anybody to play the lead for because she would pick the lead. All right, the way she would do it would be. Played the lead and the melody, the rhythm too.
To begin with, the Carters played at social and church events in their small community, but by 1927, their audience was about to change dramatically.
About 1926, the Western Electric Company invented a carbon microphone. All of a sudden, the sound was vastly improved. Now you could, in fact, put everything you needed to make a record into the back of a 1927 touring car.
Up until now, record companies based in the big cities had concentrated on classical and vaudeville music. Ralph Peer, a New York record producer, recognized that there was a demand for other types of music, including the mountain music of the South.
Peer was one of those people who had the insight to see that, aha, poor Southern whites have a distinctive sort of music which we can market to them by way of records.
The Carters heard that Ralph Peer was in Bristol, Tennessee, and that he was paying $50 to cut a record. AP convinced the others it would be worth going to one of the sessions.
I wanted to go, and they said there wasn't room for everybody, so they left me at home. Yeah, I remember them going. They was very excited about it. It was something new, something different.
The Bristol sessions were to be the big bang of country music, but for the Carters, it nearly didn't happen. The 30 miles from Clinch Mountain was a long way on rough dirt roads, and their car tires blew out. The journey took them all day. They only just made it to Pierre's temporary recording studio, set up in an old hat factory.
You got one take usually, maybe a second take if you thought you were really good, and that would be it. So you had to get it right the first time.
We recorded on the second day of August, 1927. Oh, the first song we ever did was Bury Me Under the Weeping Willow.
Everybody had to gather around the microphone. Pierre had to figure out how far people had to get in and out to get just the balance. There was no mixing board. There was no chance to hear what you were getting from the sound. So it was really quite remarkable.
Was so impressed with the Carters that he asked them to come back the following day. In all, they recorded 6 songs during these landmark sessions.
At first, they didn't even release Carter Family records. They released gospel records because Pierre felt that's what would sell well. But then when he finally released the Carter Family records, they took off like a skyrocket. And all of a sudden, Pierre realized something had indeed happened that summer in Bristol. And that what had happened basically was the birth of commercial country music.
For Ralph Pierre, the Carter family, with their huge collection of songs, were heaven sent.
They sounded very traditional, but they had songs which they claimed to have written, often songs they had found around, but they were uncopyrighted songs.
A.P. Carter did write his own lyrics, but he would also go on frequent song-finding trips. Roaming the mountains, he would collect ballads which had been handed down through families.
He was able to gather this treasure of literature, you know, these songs where people talked about life, the way life was, the way it is, their experiences, their loves, their losses, in this beautiful, clear, totally heart-on-their-sleeve poetry.
The songs that A.P. found and adapted were sung in an artlessly affecting way that has endured for generations. The influence of Maybelle's guitar style has been equally far-reaching. One of her solos is the most replicated in country music.
Mother Maybelle's Wildwood Flower, and she played it much better than that, but you could tell immediately who it was that was playing it.
Anyone who plays traditional country music owes a debt to the Carter family.
Did I know who the Carter family was when I first picked up a guitar and learned to play Wildwood Flower? No. But my dad did, and he showed me how to play it. It's the passing down of this music from generation to generation.
As the first family of country, the Carters projected a powerful image of togetherness, but their lives together were troubled.
To listen to their music only, and if you didn't know anything about the Carters, you'd think they were this wonderful, close-knit family like the Waltons. Nothing could be further from the truth.
Although they continued to record songs together, the reality was that behind the scenes, Sarah had left AP.
She left on her own. She didn't take the kids with her. That's unbelievable in 1936.
My grandmother was probably liberated before people knew the term liberated in terms of women, certainly for women in this area. She did things that other ladies didn't do, divorcing or, you know, wearing her slacks or smoking cigarettes. She was very progressive and unusual.
Went back home, Lord, my home was lonesome. Missed my mother, she was gone.
I think he probably never fully bounced back after that. It broke his heart. He never stopped loving her and never stopped getting excited when he knew that he would see her. And it's just very sad, I think, for him that, you know, as much as he loved her, they couldn't work out their problems and be together.
The 1927 Bristol sessions are famous for the discovery of the Carters. But there was a young singer there who'd also heard that Ralph Peer was talent scouting. His name was Jimmy Rogers, and he was the original kid with a guitar.
Sleep, baby,
he recorded two songs in Bristol, and Peer immediately saw his potential. Jimmy Rogers' Bristol recordings didn't sell as well as the Carters, but a later date with Peer would be a very different story. This time, Rogers came singing the blues.
When he did his second recording, he recorded his famous Blue Yodel, which is better known as T for Texas, T for Tennessee. And with that, he really put white blues on the map.
T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Delma, that gal that made a red.
T for Texas became Jimmy Rogers' signature tune. The blues influence in his music had come about through growing up in Mississippi and working on the railroads.
His father was a foreman on a section gang, which meant they were repairing railroads, and many of the workers probably were black. So he grew up in that environment, which would have reinforced this kind of knowledge of blues music.
Jimmy Rogers was forced to give up railroad work when he developed tuberculosis. Instead, he turned to a full-time career in music. Playing the blues and calling himself the singing brakeman, he became country music's first solo star.
The Carter family basically were still singing songs with roots in Victorian ethics and in sentimentality and gospel music. Here comes Jimmy Rogers, and he's basically saying, you know, I've got me a pistol and I've got me a gun. I'm going to shoot your head off.
I'm your pistol, just as long as I'm tall. I'm going to buy me a pistol, just as long as I'm tall. I'm going to shoot poor Thelma, just to see her jump and fall.
He had a voice that was recognizable and you could associate with and relate to, and he sang and wrote about the ordinary guy and at a time when the ordinary guy needed to be represented.